Hello, my name is Carly McAvoy. We're solving inequalities again and doing a little problem solving with inequalities. First of all, you should try to solve these two inequalities by yourself and see how you do. In the first one, you want to get rid of the parentheses by distributing. I'm not doing anything to the left side just yet. I'm going to write this a little smaller to fit it into the space that I didn't leave myself quite enough. Negative 8 times 1. And now I want to move my variables to the left and my constant terms to the right. And I'm going to add 8x. Negative 9 and positive 8 gives me negative x. Don't forget about the minus sign in front of your 8 that has to come down with it on that right side. Then I'm going to get rid of the positive 3 by subtracting 3. I get negative x is greater than negative 11. And now I can't leave this alone because I have to get rid of that negative in front of the x. So if I divide both sides by negative 1, well, what happens when I divide by a negative? First of all, over here, two negatives make it x, and over here, two negatives make that 11. But remember, when you multiply or divide by a negative, you've got to reverse the direction, and so that greater than becomes less than. When I want to graph that, I'd say the number I'm dealing with is 11. That's my starting point. I'm not going to shade it because there's no equal, and x is less than 11, so we're going to go to the left like that. Okay, what about this one? Well, over here, we don't have to worry about anything except just moving that variable in the constant terms. So I'm going to subtract 6y. 8y minus 6y is 2y. These go away because they're opposites. They drop out to 0. That's what I mean by go away. And now I'm going to have an additive inverse for 3, which makes that 0 as well. So I have 2y is greater than or equal to negative 1. And now I'm going to divide both sides by the coefficient, which is 2. Now my answer is negative 1/2. However, I didn't divide by a negative. I divided by positive. When you divide by a positive, you do not reverse the direction of the arrow. Even if your answer is negative, that doesn't matter. So my equation, my inequality that I'm graphing here is negative 1/2. Y is greater than or equal to. Since it's got the equal to part, we're just going to shade that right in. And everything to the right, because it's greater than. Left is less, but right, greater is right. So there's solving an equation, one where we had to reverse the direction of the arrow, and one where we didn't. You graph the final answer, not what you started with, but what your final answer is. That's what you're going to do for the graph. Okay. Translate, then solve. 6 more than twice a number is greater than negative 5. Well, is greater than is the symbol. Doesn't say or equal to. And it's greater than negative 5, so that looks like that. 6 more than twice a number. You've got twice a number. 6 more than that is plus 6. 6 more than twice a number is greater than negative 5. Going to subtract 6 from both sides. And negative 5 and negative 6 is negative 11. Hopefully by now this process is seeming pretty familiar. It's hard because you'll start writing equal sign because you forget you've been writing equal sign so much. Anyway, divide both sides by 2, and n is greater than negative 11/2. But should I be flipping the arrow here? No, I divided by a positive. If I divide by a positive, I do not flip that. And if I wanted to graph that, which the directions don't say to do, but if I did, I would say negative 11/2. I have an open circle. There's no equal to part, but it's greater than, so I would be graphing it like that. Okay. Jill got 88 and 92 on her first two tests. What would she need to get on her third test to average at least 91? Well, this calls on your skills on averaging. On what do you know how to find an average? Well, to find an average, you would take add up her three test scores and then divide by three, right? That's how you find an average of something. So let's say that her test score, T is her third test score. Okay, now we know that her first one was 88 and her second one was 92. And her third one, we don't know, well, we're calling it T. And we want to add those up and divide by 3 to get an average, right? Now, we want that average to be at least 91. What does at least mean? It means that it could be exactly 91 or it could be greater than. Is at least means 91. It means 91. Is at least means greater than or equal to. And we want that whole thing to be equal to 91 or greater than 91. So if she needs a 91 to get an A in the class, she wants to make sure she gets at least that or maybe more. The first thing I would do here is get rid of this 3 by dividing or multiplying both sides by 3. Then the 91 times 3 is what, 273? And over here, these 3's just cancel. So now I can add together, well, let me write this one more step, 88 plus 92 plus T. Now I can add 88 and 92 together, and that gives me 180. And now I'm just going to solve that by subtracting 180 from both sides. You know, you don't have to do all this stuff in your head. You're welcome to use your calculator. It's just when you use a calculator for things where it's really not necessary is when I start, oh, you're really going to do 5 times 10 on your calculator? Those kind of things you should be getting down. But some of this stuff, I'm with you. It's nice to have a calculator. Okay. So then you subtract 180 from both sides. You already just have one T. So what this means is that she needs to get a 93 or better on her last test if she's going to keep her average of 91 that she wants for some reason. Didn't really say. Okay. Let's take a look at the last problem on this set and see if we can get through it. Tyrone can spend $250 on his daughter's birthday party. The party company will do everything for an upfront cost of $30 plus $10 for every guest. How many people can Tyrone invite to the party? Don't include his daughter as a guest. So she doesn't count. How many guests can he invite? I don't know why we had to include that, but we did. So we want to say G equals the number of guests. Okay? Now, we know that there's an upfront cost of $30 plus it costs $10 for every guest. $10 times G. Now, we know that he can spend $250. He could spend exactly that. Could he spend more than $250? No. So we want to say what's going to be if it has to be less than or equal to $250? We can't go over $250. Okay. So let's subtract 30 from both sides and then divide both sides by 10. And that gives us G equals 22. Let's see what happens if he invites 22 people to that party. If he invites 22 people, he's going to pay the upfront cost. Plus, he's going to pay $10 for all those people. So that would be 30 plus 220 would be $250. If he invited 22 people, he would be getting exactly $250. Now, if he invites less than, see how I did the equal? If he invites less than 22, let's say he invites 21, 20, 19, he's going to spend less than 250. So his guess could be up to 22 or anything less than that, but no more. And nobody needs a birthday party bigger than 22. Okay, have a great day.